Hello viewers, welcome back to another session, and in this session we are going to discuss about a very interesting lesson, that is on applying psychology to education. And this is a very relevant area where we have to understand how the role of psychology is applied in education. So in this regard we are going to discuss about what education psychology is all about and how psychological principles are applied. So, our basic objective of this particular lesson would be to understand the various histories behind the school of thought or behind the school of psychology in particular, to understand its applications in the field of education psychology. Education psychology is a branch of psychology which is very much dealing with the education environment. Now, when we are talking about educational environment, to be in detail, the education environment includes the student, the teachers, the curriculum, and the various aspects related to education field. Therefore, it becomes very essential that the psychological principles are supposed to be applied even in the educational environment. As we understand that psychology discusses and deals with human behavior, education psychology deals with individual, that is the learner-centered environment. So it becomes very essential that educational psychology is a compulsory act in application of psychological principles. Now, with regard to educational psychology, there are so many experts and psychologists who have defined the education psychology. And to give an example, another important pioneer of psychology, a behaviorist called Skinner, has defined educational psychology as a field of psychology that discusses crucially about teaching and learning processes. Because of this background, many psychologists have come up with so many different disciplines or different branches of psychology, and they have explored various meanings and they have associated meanings with regard to psychology in application to education. So with this background, there are so many emergence of different schools of psychology, say for example structuralism, functionalism, gestaltism, behaviorism, cognitive psychology, and many other branches of psychologies which have evolved in this particular school of thought. To begin with, we will discuss about structuralism, which is the first school of psychology that discussed about psychology in particular and its application in education as well. Now, here is a particular important person that I would like to introduce, is Wilhelm Wundt. Now, he is a pioneer in this particular field of structuralism, and he is the person behind establishing the world's first psychological laboratory in Leipzig, that is in Germany. His intention was to establish a particular important discipline of psychology in terms of consciousness. He was interested to study the consciousness of the mind. So he felt that in order to understand the consciousness of an individual, it is very essential to conduct experiments on individuals. Now, there are some components to understand this particular consciousness, and according to Wilhelm Wundt, these consciousness concepts could be in terms of thoughts, feelings, ideas, and many other the psychological principles associated with the individual. During this course of his experimentations with individuals, he has come up with a concept called introspection method, and this method is something to do with the individual's expression of his own ideas, feelings, and thoughts, which are only observable and are felt by the individual himself. Therefore, this method has become very successful in the experimental laboratories. To be more brief about introspection method, this method is a systematic observation of an individual's thought process, feelings, perceptions, and ideas about his own understanding about a concept. Now, it has become very essential that even in the field of education psychology, consequently, the application of introspection method has become very evident both in psychology as well as educational psychology disciplines. Therefore, the contribution of Wilhelm Wundt, in particularly with structuralism, it has been beneficial for the field of education. Therefore, initiation of establishing experimental laboratories have become more evident even in the field of education and psychology as well. Now we come to another important school of thought of psychology, that is functionalism. The school of functionalism has been introduced by another pioneer called William James. Now he is the father of psychology in USA, and he is regarded as one of the pioneers of the functional school of psychology. Now he has been strongly influenced by the Darwinian theory and his own interest in the field of anatomy, physiology and medicine. Now he adopted the biological approaches to study the mind of the individuals. So he was critical with the concept of structuralism. As a result, he came up with the concept of functionalism. Let us explain. According to William James, the person who has been influenced with functionalism thought, he strongly believes that the actions or the thoughts, the ideas, the sensations, the perception of the individual have a collaborative approach. They are not considered to be separate. So there is a function which is applicable with regard to all these processes. Hence, he believed strongly that the individual has a mental life as well as his environmental applications. When we talk about the individual's mental life and his adjustment to the environment, it indicates that the individual has to deal with many challenges around his environment and he has to adjust and adapt to the environmental conditions. To his knowledge, functionalism has more practical applications with regard to psychology, whereas structuralism was not practical according to William James. Especially, the methods and techniques of learning were made more functionable with regard to educational setup. To explain much further, it is like the functionalist, one of these functionalists or one of the follower of William James called Dewey, he felt that the emphasis of education and teaching methods should not be related to the subject matter, but it has something to do with the individual student concern or the needs of the students are well established. And as a result of this particular school of thought, the need for learner-centered approaches have been more beneficial and crucial in the field of educational psychology, where the concentration was more with the student approach. And to the credit of functionalism, it can also be understood that it has opened the way of the study of psychology in terms of adjustment of the individual or the student with regard to its environment. And as a result, it also dealt not only with the normal individuals, it also dealt with abnormal individuals with regard to its adaptation to the environmental conditions. So in this particular school of functionalism, it is not only limited to the normal individuals, but it has extended its application in terms of understanding and studying the abnormal behavior of individuals. Another important and very challenging school of psychology is behaviorism. And behaviorism is very, very important and a relevant field of psychology nowadays. And the father of this particular school was John Watson. Now he has put forward an entirely new concept of behaviorism, and which was quite contrary to structuralism and functionalism. And his concept was that any behavior of an individual is observable and measurable. That means it is very evident that a behavior is observable directly. And this particular observed behavior can also be measured. He was critical of structuralism and functionalism because he was not able to agree to the concept that consciousness cannot be seen. It can only be felt by the individual subject himself or herself. Therefore, it is quite difficult to understand the structuralist point of view as well as the functionalist point of view. Therefore, the behaviorists strongly believed that the student behavior or any individual behavior for that matter can be observed directly. In this particular continuation of school of behaviorism, there are two important people. One is Ivan Pavlov, a Russian physiologist who discussed about classical conditioning, and it has become a very famous theory of learning in the field of psychology as well as education. And Skinner is another important contributor to the field of behaviorism in terms of operant conditioning, where he introduced the concept of shaping behavior through rewards and punishments. Now, the task of shaping behavior has become more successful in the field of education because it is quite applied in terms of rewards, in terms of punishments, in terms of appraising the students. Therefore, the classical conditioning and the operant conditioning principles are quite operating in the field of educational psychology as well. The behaviorist or the school of behaviorism strongly believed that heredity has no role to play when it comes to observing the behavior of the individuals. Therefore, they have not given any priority to the heredity factors at all. And it has also highlighted the role of environment. They strongly believe that environment shapes the individual's behavior. Therefore, they have focused more on the environmental conditions. Therefore, they have emphasized more on the environmental conditions in order to shaping the behavior of children especially. The field of behaviorism has influenced in such a way that it has applied in all the fields of training, rehabilitation, and also by emphasizing a greater need to provide the best possible learning situations and environments, especially towards the better growth and development of children. This approach has been successful even in the application of the abnormal psychology as well, in terms of working with abnormal patients and individuals suffering from anxiety and behavioral problems. And also there are many school related problems where the child is suffering from. As a result, this field of psychology has ushered a new field in this particular era of psychology. The school of behaviorism has advocated reinforcement as one of the most crucial concept in order to shaping the behavior of individuals, especially the negative behaviors are concerned. There are so many principles of reinforcements in terms of token economy, in terms of reinforcement, in terms of systematic desensitization, which all have been crucial and contributed to a lot of behavior change in the individuals. Now we are talking about another important school, that is the school of gestaltism. Now this school of gestaltism has contributed a vast majority of the curricula related in the educational field. So the gestalts maintained that the whole is greater than some of its constituents. It is a holistic perspective. Say for example, especially it has become more successful in the field of education in developing curriculum, in developing the subject matter. When we discuss about a curriculum or when we discuss about a subject, the subject is considered to be a gestaltic perspective, because in a subject it is only related to the concepts related to the subject only. Say for example, if we talk about social studies, it is discussing only the concepts related to the social aspects of the society as well as the individual. Therefore, the gestalt principle has become more successful in the field of education. The gestalt principle has laid greater emphasis on the role of motivation and definite goals in the purpose and in the type of learning among the students. And also the holistic perspective has given rise to the holistic approach of the student, teacher, the administration, the curriculum as a whole. The emphasis of setting up clear-cut objectives and defining in a definite behavioral terms and linking education with the needs and motives of the students, and it has been said that there is a greater emphasis of gestalt principles in this particular aspect. And most importantly, gestalt field of thought has a notable feature that it makes the task of perception, learning and problem solving aspects of the individual in an intelligent manner. Most importantly, the gestalt principle has been a sensation in terms of providing a scientific and a progressive method of problem solving skills among the students. The next important school of psychology that we are going to discuss is about psychoanalysis. A pioneer, a successful person about who behind this particular school of psychoanalysis is Sigmund Freud. And this movement of Sigmund Freud presented a new dimension in the field of psychology. To begin with, the influence of psychoanalysis has been very crucial and it is very significant impact on the individual's personality. To begin with, Sigmund Freud talked about the various structures of mind, the levels of mind like consciousness, subconsciousness, unconsciousness, and also he talked about psychosexual stages of the individuals, and as a result he has talked about the entire personality aspects of the individual including the sexuality. In his theory he has given sex as one of the important rightful place in the realm of human behavior, and his concept will always remain as a praiseworthy and more memorable concept in the field of psychology. According to Freud, he strongly believed that the earlier experiences or the childhood experiences are very, very crucial in the development of the child's personality. Therefore, he strongly focused that the childhood experiences or the early experiences of children need to be groomed in a positive direction. And there were some followers of Sigmund Freud in his psychoanalytic approach later who separated from him and developed different concepts away from his concepts. Say for example, Alfred Adler and Carl Jung have developed different concepts though following the concepts of Sigmund Freud. Alfred Adler was one person who worked in the area of individual psychology and Carl Jung in terms of analytical psychology. Now we are going to talk about the recent developments of various schools of psychology, or we are going to talk about the contemporary disciplines of psychology in particular. Nowadays, if we look at the various schools of psychology, now there is an eclectic approach or there is a combination of many approaches applying in the field of education and psychology. However, the two important schools of psychology, behaviorism and psychoanalysis, are the two major aspects of forces at work in the contemporary psychology as well. And further to discuss the cognitive psychology, transpersonal psychology and humanist psychology have also included into the contemporary psychology. To begin with, let us discuss about humanistic psychology. The pioneer behind humanistic psychology was Carl Jung and Abraham Maslow in particular, and Rollo May and Arthur Combs were also working in the field of humanistic psychology. The major aim of humanistic psychology is to understand a human being as an individual entity with fullest potentials and abilities. The individuals who are working in the field of humanistic psychology strongly believe that every individual possesses some potentialities or abilities and skills in him, and there is a possibility of expressing and showing his abilities to the fullest. And the abilities or achieving their goals can be in terms of satisfying their basic needs, say for example food, water or any basic biological need that is of their concern and satisfaction. Humanist psychologists, they have emphasized that the individuals, the human behavior is distinctively a very important concern of the personality of the individual, and every individual has a freedom of will, freedom of choice in order to fulfill his potentials. Therefore, the humanist psychology, they have considered the individual as the utmost priority because they possess particular strengths and they have the ability to fulfill their needs and goals. Therefore, it is quite evident even in the field of education that the humanist perspective is very evident in the student life as well. Now we are going to talk about transpersonal psychology, a very recent discipline of psychology which has more application with regard to the individuals, which is more prevalent with regard to contemporary psychology. It is the work of Abraham Maslow, who talked about self-actualization. If you remember the theory of motivation, where Maslow talks about the various hierarchies of needs, and the highest hierarchy of need is self-actualization. That means the individual's utilization of his or her own potentialities towards the fullest. The transpersonal psychology focuses that how the individual thinks, how the individual feels is especially in the altered states. is the subject area of transpersonal psychology. So, the way we think in the present situation or the conscious situation is different from that of the individual in an altered condition. And to continue the altered state of condition, it could be during the time of distress or during the time of extreme sadness, or sometimes it is during the time of extreme excitement and happiness also. Sometimes the altered states can also be aroused during the time of sleep or during the time of deep concentration. Sometimes experimentally it has been found that they may be also induced with the help of specific drugs or religious conversations, yoga, and sometimes transcendental meditation, which can be crucial in order to identify the altered states of consciousness of the individual. Now we are going to discuss about cognitive psychology, a recent field and an emerging field which has been crucial in the various domains of all the faculties of psychological principles. Cognitive psychology studies about the individual's thinking, memory, learning, problem solving, creativity, and many others. But it is considered that cognitive psychology is the highest field in order to identify the higher order thinking capacities. The cognitive psychologists believe that there is more to learning and behaving rather than to responding to a particular stimuli. There is a lot of problem solving, there is a lot of information processing that is involved in a particular action. Therefore, it is not limited to reacting to a stimulus. Therefore, cognitive psychology is related to the interpretation and the use of certain information and processing of the information and reacting to that particular situation. There are many pioneers in this field of cognitive psychology. Say for example, Edward Tolman, he has worked about a lot in the field of cognitive psychology, beginning from creativity, learning, thinking and concept formation, and also problem solving skills. A very important observation in the field of cognitive psychology is that the individual tries to assume or hypothesize or attempts to set a particular hypothesis and then react in such a way so that that particular hypothesis is achieved through a particular purposeful behavior, which is very, very essential, and it is very much evident in the cognitive psychology applications. Another important pioneer called Jean Piaget, a Swiss psychologist who has been the prominent contributor in the field of cognitive psychology. He has been working with children in the field of cognitive development and cognitive ability development, where he strongly believes that the stages of development or the stages of cognitive development is evident during the formative years of the child. So far we have understood that to understand the application of psychology in the field of education, there has been a tremendous work of many psychologists from the different disciplines and different schools of psychology, and each of these particular schools have been focusing on different domains and dimensions of individual personality. But it is very essential that all these different schools of psychology have contributed something or the other in the field of education. Therefore, it is very necessary to consider all the different schools of psychology in application of these principles in the field of education. And there is always advantages and limitations of each school of psychology. Therefore, it becomes very crucial to take one particular school of psychology into consideration when we are discussing about the application part in the field of education. Therefore, it is a holistic approach, and sometimes one school is dominant than the other school, but it is a collaborative approach of the field of education to incorporate various concepts, various principles from each school of psychology.